warm up into this week's edition of the WCS Sports Connection. I'm your co-host, Jeremy Qualls, and with me, as always, is Tate Matthews. Today, we're joined by a very special guest, our friend, the new head coach of the Nolensville Knights, and as well, athletic director. How are you doing today, Will Hester?
Doing wonderful.
Excellent. Before we get into our chalk talk, let's talk a few things, do some house cleaning. End of the year, Tate, we finished out, the WCS Sports Conference finished out pretty strong. We went from 17 state championships last year to 22, Tate.
Pretty impressive. Five more from the last year, and I'm sure you do, if you ran a study on this or not, but I'm guessing that's the most of any school system in the state, state championship-wise for 2015-2016, I would guess.
It is, but the funny thing is we talk about, you see the Rutherford counties come across a lot, talking about how strong they are in sports. We always are, I don't want to use the word, clouded over with academics, but I think that we get lost in the mix. Our academics is so high-performing that we tend to forget that our athletics is extremely important as well as the academics portion. But if you look at it from a statewide perspective, like you just mentioned, the athletic performance is as high as the academic performance. If you look at the overall state championships, if you look at we had three national rankings this year. We went from one to three. In the fall alone, we went from three state championships to seven. I mean, it's just phenomenal, the growth that we've had. You look at the overall student participation from 4,100 athletes last year to 4,400 athletes. The scholarships from 81 to 112 college signees. I mean, our growth is just is on par with the academics.
And that's, Coach Hester can speak to that. That's one of the things I'm proudest of, is you mentioned those 22 state championships, and almost all of those are multi-sport athletes. That's what I like the most.
You have a lot of kids in there that play two and sometimes even three sports. That's why we're so successful. And not only are we doing that, let's talk about what the coach's duties are. Will here is the coach. Now he's fixing to pull double duty as athletic director, knowing that the time frame that the athletic programs, the teams, the coaches have to do with the academic load here in Williamson County is such a different dynamic than maybe a Rutherford County, a Montgomery County, a Metro, anywhere else, because you don't ever get your guys during the day. You have to do a full case load. You have to lift weights, video. Everything is pretty much after school. Your hours are long, and you've got kids that are on AP. We'll talk about the load that you have, not only as athletically, but to accommodate for the academics as well.
Well, I mean, as you stated, we don't have a class during the school day where we have all of our athletes together. So everything we do is either before or after school. Just speaking of the Ravenwood coaching staff last year, there were four coaches that taught AP classes, some of them multiple preps in AP, which, you know, lends itself to a lot of time grading, a lot of papers, preparing a lot of DBQs, they call them. And so, you know, that is on top of everything else that they were already doing. So, you know, and these kids are the same way. Those same kids that may take one AP class generally take multiple AP classes, especially in your junior year at Ravenwood High School. That was a big deal. And there's a lot of kids that taking multiple AP classes. So, you know, it's a full-time job for these kids. And, you know, and the way that they're able to balance the academics with the athletics and get everything they need done, it's a big deal. But we also try to keep in mind, you know, and be cognizant of that. We don't, there are some school systems and teams out there that practice 4 or 5 hours a day. You know, we never had a practice over 90 minutes at Ravenwood High School, and that was on the field. Obviously, we'd do some film stuff and some weight stuff outside of that, but we were on and off the field in 90 minutes every single day last year. So you got to be cognizant of that fact when you're playing practice.
I think that's one of the things I'm most proud of with our guys is it seems like we have a lot of hurdles that we have to clear conference-wise as coaches and as athletes and as teams. You know, we get split up with the classifications that, you know, it may not go in our favor. Our travel time increases, particularly on the 5A level, 6A level, you guys have to go out as well. We you know, win both 5A and 6A rings. On top of that, even though they're throwing curveballs at us, we have to, right now the WCS is looking at approaching 24 as an average ACT, maybe even 25. And I mean, it's just phenomenal the things that we're pulling off at this level. Not only that, for the first time, we're looking at multiple calls that I've had this year in the offseason of not only people calling about checking into sports, but they're moving specifically because of sports, not just because of academics. So I can see the trend going, and it, you know, it works for the student athlete in both favors. It's getting them prepped for college, not only on the athletic level, but academic level as well. Another thing I'm proud of here is the coaches' performance space, something we put in last year. We finished the year at 23,000. As fall concluded this year, we had already surpassed 23,000, and we finished at 46,000 to help compensate our coaches for winning. We're very proud of the fact of the coaches that are super successful. We want to pay them accordingly. With that being said, let's do a quick roundup of what's happening right now on the radar for our student athletes prior to going into this. What's happened, Tate, here recently on the football radar as far as recruiting happenings?
Well, we mentioned last week with Coach Blade, obviously Landon Guidry committing to Mississippi State as I believe he said he thinks he's going to be a safety. Coach Hester's had guys like that before, obviously with Van Jefferson. He can tell you. Just because they offer you doesn't mean that they want you to commit right now. And so the fact that they let him commit right now means they really, really want him, right? And that's big for him. Brent Smaglia, the kicker from Page, he's been offered a full ride. That doesn't happen very often. A lot of times they try to get him to come in gray shirt or even sit for a year and walk on and then maybe earn their scholarship. Coach Hester coached a guy like that in Wesley Horky, a long snapper. He started 2 years at Oklahoma. They gave him a full ride. What does all that mean? If they offer you a full ride as a kicker or a long snapper, you're one of the best in the country. So those two things were really, really big for the sports conference in football right now.
Well, actually, we talked off there, Patrick Light and Ravenwood with Duke. Max Ray right now, class of 17, 18, with the top offensive tackle prospects there is right now. I mean, he's got offers from everybody. Right now, locked into UGA. They think that's pretty heavy right now. They think that that's pretty solid. I don't see that until the year goes, as the year progresses. We'll see how that operates. Tyrell Dotson going to A&M. Nate Johnson right now. There's big reports coming out of up north out of Michigan talking about where Nate Johnson's going to play punt return and some other positions there that looking at big things. Van Jefferson report right now looks like at Ole Miss after redshirting this past year. Looks like could possibly pick up some playing time and be a big role for Ole Miss?
Absolutely. I mean, he was named they call it the Eli Manning Award for the spring practice, which is basically their MVP of spring ball. Great spring out of Van. The thing I'm most proud of, I think he had a 3.8 GPA his first year down there. Good for him. He's back, they gave him a little time off and they're already back down there for the summer now and doing 7-on-7, all that kind of stuff. So they expect big things out of him.
Basketball also happening right now, summer camps. Grayson Murphy picking up some serious traction right now. Jacksonville State, Furman, UT Martin, Belmont. OVC schools right now falling like dominoes. I figured that will pick up even more as time goes through. I have to give a shout out, Bryce Denton. Bryce Denton, as we all know, was selected 66 from the Cardinals last year from Ravenwood. He goes from the Gulf Coast League, which is the lowest form of rookie ball, up to Johnson City. That's where they all start. And he's starting this week for Johnson City. That's a big plus for him right now. He's ranked number 13th in the entire Cardinals organization as far as future prospects. Our guy, Will Dalton, gets selected 871st to the Orioles. He's going to San Jacinto State. The Gators, Pasadena, Texas. You want to name some of their alumni? Does anybody know they've had 6 Cy Young, 1 American League MVP go through this place? Do you have any idea who some of their?
I have no clue. Ozzie Smith.
Andy Pettit and Roger Clemens. You saw that on the paper. So, with that being said, that gives a roundup concluded. I will now throw it to you guys for the Chalk Talk take.
Well, we started this last week. And by the way, glad to have you back. You look.
I just completely wasted 9 minutes of your time.
Well rested and refreshed, and I know you had a good time down at the House of the Mouse, so glad to have you back. So last week we started, the Sports Connection Football 101. We had Coach Blade in. He was talking the Independence offense. We did the state championship game. We're going to do the 6A state championship game today with Coach Hester. Coach, this is Football 101. Put us inside the headset. Inside the staff room, we explained to everybody what huddle was last year. You all run a little bit different defense than Independence. Maryville, when you're talking about offense, is there anybody in the state any more multiple than Maryville on offense?
No, I would say George Quarles does about as good a job as anybody as far as attacking people's defenses and trying to put you in a bind. What we've got pulled up here, this is actually their first offensive play of the game. We're what we call an odd front defense. I mean, we've got a guy lined up on the center all the time. and so that was what creates the odd, meaning there are three down linemen for their five offensive linemen, and we'll have two outside linebackers within the space there. But we're a slant and angle 3-4 team, meaning those three guys that are lined up on the old linemen are moving one way or the other on every single snap.
And you're calling that, right?
Right. That's the defensive huddle call. Coach Derek was the defensive coordinator for us at Ravenwood, and he is at Nolensville now as well. And basically what we're going to do is we're going to tell the entire front that you're going to go right or left, basically. We have different ways of getting into that. It may be based off where the tight end's lined up. It may be field and boundary. It may be all those different things. But it's going to be based off of the offense of our opponent, what the breakdown looks like. You know, they may be heavy to the field, or they may be heavy to the tight end, or quite frankly, it may be a certain receiver that they're going to point the offense at. Whatever it is, you know, that's what our defensive staff's goal is throughout the weekend leading up to that, is to identify, you know, what are the indicators that are going to tip their hand, if there are any, and can we put our kids in a situation to be successful with that?
Well, and at Ravenwood High School, you don't have 280, 290-pound defensive tackles. These are guys that are usually about 200, maybe 215. And so what we're trying to do is, off the ball, we're slanting one way. We're trying to get skinny and get in between them, get in the backfield and disrupt, right?
Yep. You know, it's not as much as about getting in the backfield. It's about holding their gap integrity. Everybody plays a gap control defense these days, meaning all these 11 guys that are assigned out there are assigned a specific spot on the field, basically. The guys up front, you know, have a position, some piece of grass or dirt between one of the linemen and maybe the tight end, or between the guard and the center, or the guard and the tackle, whatever. Everybody's responsible for a spot. And if we keep our head and our body in that dirt, you play good defense. I mean, that's all about it is, you know, owning your piece of dirt. We tell the guys, don't try to do anything more or anything less than what we ask you to do. If you do your job and everybody else does theirs, you play good team defense.
So Maryville's got three to the right side of the field. They got a trips.
Yeah, we treated that guy almost like a tight end. He's in the slot there, about one by one off the tackle. So, you know, this is our base alignment. So the ball's on the left hash. So we've got what we call a field corner, and we got what we call a boundary corner. So we teach these two guys a toolbox of things. We basically let the secondary dictate what coverage they're playing. You know, we'll tell them whether we want to be in a two-high look or a single-high look, meaning how many safeties deep that is. But it's Coach Derek's job Monday through Thursday to teach these guys what we want them in. And it's basically based off of what Maryville does here. So, you know, we've got a two-high safety look right now, so we're playing basically quarter-quarter, and that safety's playing the half on the backside. This corner is what we call, you know, a knife situation, meaning if he gets run to him right now, he can actually beat that receiver inside and become like an extra outside linebacker. So that's what we're trying to do, is gain an extra guy to the run, and this, by doing it this way, it's this boundary corner here.
So just like with Coach Blade last week, it's all a numbers game.
Absolutely. We're trying to cheat the game by showing a pass-heavy defense and playing a run-heavy defense. So their first play here is a play that killed us the year before in the state championship game. You know, Coach Quarles, being a great coach that he is, wanted to come test our oil and see if we had made some adjustments. Coach Derek has the perfect call here. We're actually going to stunt this outside linebacker inside and make the play on the draw here. And if you look at it from the end zone shot, it's a little better view. But this is our side that we're moving, so everybody up front is moving from the right to the left as we're looking at it here. This outside linebacker is going to switch responsibilities with this defensive end and go underneath the formation, creating kind of a conflict for the guard, because he's not expecting that guy to do that, and it opens him up to be able to make the play here. So the perfect call at the right time for a negative play to start the game, which, you know, kind of sets the tone. You know, they ripped us pretty well on this play. That's probably a play they had talked all week about. You know, this is something we've got. You know, we're going to hit them right with this. They may not have an answer for it based off of last year. And then we were able to make a play for no gain to start the game there.
You know, you think about that. You think about that one particular play. As a coach, you have spent hours on watching game film of what they did last year. And just like you said, they keyed on a play that you struggled with last year. You make adjustments. The normal fan don't even see this. And that right there is a huge battle won in the whole war of trying to win this game, of a simple, you know, it can be demoralizing for the other team. The other team's like, man, you know, that worked last year. Now we're going to have to go to plan B and look at something else to try to do them. So, I mean, it's interesting to see this point of view.
And, you know, it's definitely a cat and mouse game between that offensive play caller and the defensive play caller. You know, that last play, we brought an extra guy off the weak side edge there. We played too high behind it. You know, this next snap here, basically a very similar formation. They've got twins to the field, one receiver to the boundary with two backs in the backfield. But now, to us, two backs in the backfield for them, that's one of their run-heavy sets. They're going to run the ball quite a bit out of that. So we know that we want to get an extra guy in the box. So we're going to actually spin the coverage. You can kind of see Nate Stoner spinning back to center field here. And we're going to work Andrew Lugens down in the box to get that eighth defender in the box and play basically, you know, a 4-4, but we're moving to it. We're not lining up in it, so all those offensive linemen don't know which direction we're going. On the snap of the ball, those guys move. Lugens works down. And it's a great throw and catch by the young sophomore quarterback from Maryville and the slot receiver there. So here it is from the backside. You know, you can see Nate start working to center field to play that cover three look. The guy sits down in the void between the two inside linebackers, and it's a big play. But what you see in the background there is that little yellow handkerchief that the guy in the white hat throws. So it's a beautiful play. But they call a hold right there on the nose of the center on Jordan Moore. Jordan Moore was probably the catalyst for our defense all year. But if you'll watch him, Jordan gets off on the center right here. The center has to hold Jordan. That's what the referee sees. And there comes the yellow flag out. And what was a big play would have been first down yardage for Maryville. Now ends up being a holding penalty from the spot of the foul, which happens in the backfield there. So it's a tough, tough penalty for those guys there. But great play by Jordan, getting pressure on the quarterback and forcing that.
So mention one thing we heard Coach Derek talking a lot about. I know at halftime, that was one of – after you gave your talk, that was one of his big talks. Fit. Keep making your fits. Kind of explain to us rookies, the 101 students here, what is the – you mentioned how – the line is going to play, okay? So if we're whichever way they go on this side, explain to them the linebackers, the fit. What is the fit and what is it you're expecting out of them? Because, again, you know they're going one way and they're taking a spot.
Absolutely.
How are the linebackers fitting up with the line?
All right, so basically the linebackers, it's their responsibility to play the uncovered gaps that the linemen don't take care of. So the way we've got it set up here, we're moving this formation from – the tight end side here. All right, so if you work it back a little bit, Brad Bladorn, the left defensive end here, is responsible for what is B gap. That's the area between that tackle and the guard right there. That's where he's responsible for.
Regardless of what the guard and tackle do.
Regardless.
Play that gap.
That gap's going to move.
Do
right?
Your job.
On the snap, those guys are moving. Brad's got to make sure he keeps his head in that spot. Same with Jordan Moore here. He's moving one way or the other. And the same, I believe that's Jack Kopecky there at the right defensive end. He's moving one way or the other. So the two inside linebackers, Sean Spence and John Thompson, when those four guys move, and I'm including the outside linebacker, ideally Babaloa, in that movement there, creates two spots that don't have anybody in it. All right? It's their spot to fill those, okay? And we use what's called basically a daylight and dark read, meaning it as things move, it's either going to open up, there's going to be daylight there, or it's going to be wadded up and it's going to be dark there. So those guys continue to scrape or move with the direction of the ball until daylight opens. When daylight opens, they feel the daylight. That's what we talk about filling it.
Because that's what the running back's looking for.
Too. Absolutely. All right, so there's the quarterback draw. Yep, you see Sean Spence there scraping. All right, so they pull the backside guard. So it's basically a power blocking scheme up front. So the way we play the power blocking scheme is up and under with the front side backer and running the backside backer over the top. So Sean is the front side backer. He's up and under. John Thompson's coming over the top. And then Nate Stoner is going to play the bounce there, play the spill. And, you know, if John gets too wide, Nate's in a good enough position that he can make him right. What would be him making right is he can fall back inside. And, you know, that's a good play on the quarterback draw there, forcing the fourth down where they're going to have to punt. So the opening drive of the game, we stop the draw play that they killed us on the year before. We give up a pass play, but it becomes very clear their center's going to struggle with our nose guard. They get a holding penalty, and then we stop them here on the draw and force them in a fourth down punting situation to start the ball game. And then they have to punt.
Now, he's a guy who gambles a little bit. How much you always have to be ready for it, but how much fake punting and kicks like that does he do during the year?
Not as much fake punting. He's a humongous trick play guy. It's usually always built in the offense. Now, like a guy like Jerry Joslin is going to fake a punt or two or three every single game, and you have to prepare all week for that. But Coach Quarles was not a big a fake punt guy. So there's a good punt fielded by Chris Rowland, who's a dynamic athlete for us. They do a good job on the punt coverage of getting him down on the ground. That's a punt safe situation for us where we're not trying to block the kick. We're just trying to get the ball turned over back to our offense. So just as important as we set the tone on defense, getting a stop, making them punt the football early in the game there, you want to do the same thing, but the reverse of it on offense. You want to drive down and try to get some points and put them in a situation to start the game. So, you know, this is our first offensive series. We're kind of backed up here. You know, one thing that we failed to do last year is we didn't feel like in the championship game the previous year that we forced ourselves to run the football. We felt like we gave up on the run a little bit. We had a lot of success throwing the football, but we felt like we gave up on the run. But, you know, this is just the basic of the basic inside zone run play for us. So we've got a tight end in the game. They're an even front team, which is the opposite of us. So the center is an uncovered guy. Every time our center comes to the line of scrimmage, he makes an odd or an even call. If he's covered, it's an odd call. If he's uncovered, it's an even call. Now, obviously, there's some variations of that that we may have to talk about from week to week, like a 3-3 stack. We make a stat call, but we don't see those very – we see those very rarely. Actually, we see almost 100% odd fronts just like us now. And very few even fronts like Maryville. But, you know, what they've given us is we have a tight end in the game. So we have five linemen and a tight end, so six blockers, if you will. We treat our quarterback as a blocker, meaning Andrew's going to do a good job of reading one of their defenders here on the inside zone read and basically block a guy by reading a guy. All right, so we've got seven people blocking, and the way Maryville's aligned to us is they have six guys in the box. So just like Coach Blade talked about counting last week, same thing for us. Six in the box versus seven. We got one more than they got. We're going to try to cram the football.
We like that.
We like that. Now, the thing you don't like is when they have six and you have seven and you run it and you still can't get no yards. You don't like that because it's going to be a long night. If they can handle your numbers, you're in trouble. So this is just an inside run play for us. All right, so what we're trying to do is, and we do it a little different than everybody else. The three technique here is to the top. So that's a Tavion Mills and Patrick Light. Patrick, the Duke commit that we just talked about at right tackle here. When we run the inside zone play, we're actually trying to cram it in this cylinder right here. If you'll see, there's a natural seam from their shade or one technique to the three technique. And these linebackers, right, you know, they know that we run zone read. They know that quarterback can pull the ball. That's T.D. Blackman, one of the best players in the state of Tennessee. You know, he has to make a decision whether he's going to honor the dive or he's going to play the quarterback.
And that's how the quarterback blocks him, by making him – he's got to honor it until he gives the ball or keeps it.
And then he becomes a blocker as soon as the ball's handed.
Right. So what we're trying to do with these two guys is get a vertical double team on this three technique to the point where Tavion can come off to block TD and Patrick can overtake that guy. All right? So – when we hit play here, we get that situation. Now, Tavion's coming off, Patrick's overtaking the three technique, and we have a natural seam here with a hat on a hat. You know, so if Connor does a trip here, this could go to the house. So
he's second level, and 14 is going to have to make a heck of a play.
Right. And then he bends it back maybe a little quicker than we wanted to, loses his feet a little bit, but still – that's a great situation for us. And now that we have technology on the sidelines, you know, Coach Burrow, our offensive line coach, will have this on the iPad in between series. And we can see that we're getting the situation that we want. So we're going to come back to this. So, you know, we're a up-tempo, hurry-up offense. So we actually are going to run the exact same play again the very next snap. We run it again. They wad it up. Don't get as much the second time around. We don't get that situation that we wanted. So now it's third down and medium for us. So third down and medium for us. Chris Rowland is our ball player. We're going to try to get that ball in his hands. Still early in the game, trying not to put Andrew in a tough situation, throwing the football. You know, we're backed up a little bit, so we're going to run the option. We get the ball pulled and pitched here on the perimeter, and then Chris does what he does.
That's not your
and picks up a
that's
play.
Not your 1980s option either. That's a pretty neat
it
twist
is,
on it.
But it's but it's dressed up a little.
Right, right.
And then it takes an athlete. Let's be honest. I mean, Chris Rowland makes an unbelievable missed tackle to get the first down right here, right as they're converging on him, right here on the cutback. Boom.
Yep.
And then makes the play.
And then the first down, first down of the game, keeps the drive alive. You know, to me, what that shows is how the first series on defense we did what we were supposed to do and get off the field. First series on offense. In order to build that, can we beat these guys mentality? They've won 44 straight games. You know, they're ranked in the country. All the talk's about Maryville. We stop them on and make them punt on their first series, and we pick up a first down on ours. You know, to me, that kind of set the tone. It basically set the mentality that we have a chance.
You set aside X's and O's, though. You did a remarkable job of making the kids believe. I mean, that's what I see from the innocent bystander piece. When you go into the locker rooms, you listen to, you know, the X's and O's are there. They knew what they were doing. Y'all had done a phenomenal job of preparing them for this game. But there's still a piece of that you've got to get in there and you've got to make them believe. And those kids, there was no doubt in their mind in the first half, and particularly in that first series coming out in the second half, that this game was going to be, you know, they were not going to lose this game. And that you are to be commended on that, because, I mean, that really squarely falls on your job, not only the preparation of the week at hand, but you've got to go in there and you've got to sell this game plan to these kids. And they bought it. They went in there and they worked it. And the results are you know, the 6A state championship for you guys and breaking the string of Maryville, David slaying a lie, fill in the blank, whatever it may be. You know, just a phenomenal game on your behalf.
Yeah, I mean, you can't say enough about what the kids did. You know, that it was all about them. You know, it makes it easy to motivate kids who want to be motivated. And, you know, right. Their slogan from the get-go, those seniors decided their slogan this year was going to be to leave no doubt. So when they decide that that's what it's going to be, it's easy to remind them of that. So, you know, they made a conscious effort as 36 seniors to come up with a slogan, and it was leave no doubt, and we made sure they knew going to the game that they had a chance to do that.
Well, Tate, I want to apologize. We absolutely spent too much time on house cleaning. Should have spent more time on this. Oh, this is phenomenal. I look forward to continuing this series as we go down the road here, working our way to football. Thank you so much for joining us today. Look forward to seeing what Knowlesville – hey, give us a real quick update, 20 seconds, Knowlesville Athletics.
It's coming together. Heard, you know, all the teams have basically held trials at this point. Just about all the teams are selected. They'll have another fall trial for new move-ins, but everything's up and running.
Turf is down. We look forward to bringing game day to the Nolensville community.
September 2nd.
September 2nd, he says. He's already called it. So it's going to be interesting. I can't wait to see it. Thank you so much for joining us. This has been WCS Sports Connection. We'll see you next time. We'll be right back.